The Theory of Knowledge, an Islamic Perspective by Ayatollah Murtuda Mutahhari. In our discussion on the stages of knowledge, we arrived at the conclusion that the theory on knowledge as a single stage has only a few proponents. There have been people in the world who have regarded knowledge as having a single stage and referring only to the sensory perceptions. There have been people who also have treated knowledge as having a single stage and denoting intellection. Since these theories have only a few proponents, we will refrain from discussing them. Besides, while dealing with other subjects, the invalidity of these theories will be clarified anyway. Sensory knowledge turning into logical knowledge. Man has a basic and direct relation with the objective world, which is nothing but sensory relation. After the stage of sensory perceptions, it is the mind which in its own realm brings the sensory perceptions up to the stage of intellection, as well as the sensory superficial knowledge up to the stage of logical profound knowledge. It is here that a serious problem arises, and that is, how can the second stage acquire credibility? The credibility of the first stage is at least clear from the very outset. I say that this hall is rectangular. Why? It is because I see it as rectangular in shape. It requires no other reason. I perceive the hall in such a way that it is rectangular. So, it is rectangular. There is no problem or question so long as we are in the stage of superficial knowledge, because superficial knowledge is the effect of direct relation between our sensory faculties and the objective world. In the stage of superficial knowledge, man is like a camera in front of a view whose picture is taken as it is. It is acceptable to all and sundry that the next stage, that is, the stage of intellection or the stage of logical knowledge, in which our knowledge is profound as well as vast and extended, whose vastness I will explain in due time, while this expansion is done by no other than the mind, is not an effect of the relation between the mind and the external world. The mind performs a sort of operation in its own realm, which turns superficial knowledge into logical knowledge and elevates a type of knowledge from a lower stage to a higher one, while this has nothing to do with the direct relation between the mind and the objective world. An example is a camera which takes a picture of a view. Then, inside the dark room, the photographer makes a set of modifications to the photos to be developed. For instance, if 10 people pose for a picture, he turns them into 1,000, 10,000, or an infinite number of people. The mind, this extraordinary and stupendous apparatus whose function cannot be limited to picture-taking, takes picture of limited views through its photographic devices, aka the senses. Then, in its own dark room, the mind turns this film of a small view into a vast, greater, or even infinite view. This is while the credibility of those intangible and expanded things, which the mind itself has captured through a process of generalization without considering the external world, is in no way lesser than that which is actually taken by this apparatus. In fact, they are equal. Marxism and its relapse into idealism. Many things have been written about epistemology, but believe me, many of these writers do not know what they are writing about and what the main question is. Some say that the mind generalizes. In fact, the question lies in this generalization. Only a limited number of philosophers have paid attention to this point related to epistemology. Our predecessors, such as Abu Ali ibn Sina, Khawaja Nasruddin Tusi, and others, as well as modern philosophers like Kant and others, have paid attention to this point. But the rest basically do not know what the main question in epistemology is. The Marxists have found a good solution. Their solution is as follows. They say that this sensory superficial knowledge, which is the effect of the direct relation between the mind and the objective world, turns into logical knowledge in the brain or the mental realm through the law of passing from quantity to quality. They make this statement and they persist in believing it thinking that the main problem has been solved. What does passing from the stage of quantity to that of quality actually mean? If a series of changes gradually takes place on a natural substance, the nature or essence of this thing is preserved while it undergoes a gradual transformation. But this gradual change cannot reach the point of infinity. As it reaches a certain point, the subject has no longer the same nature as it turns into another thing or nature. It is like the process of turning copper into gold, which alchemists used to perform in the past. Let us cite a simpler example which Hegel himself has cited. He says that if you boil some water and from 0 degrees its temperature becomes 1 degree, 2 degrees, 5 degrees, 50 degrees, 90 degrees, and finally it reaches 99 degrees. When it reaches 100 degrees, the water suddenly turns into steam, and the steam is no longer water. The laws pertaining to liquid substances are no longer applicable to it. It is now subject to the laws pertaining to gaseous substances. We have said time and time again that if we want to state in precise philosophical terms passing from quantity to quality, which is discussed nowadays, we have to say passing from quantitative changes to qualitative changes. That is, the nature of thing basically changes. Those who say so, notwithstanding their acceptance of the expression, acknowledge that when a thing undergoes change from quantitative to qualitative, in reality, its nature is changed. This expression, used also by Hegel, is inappropriate. That is, it is not these quantitative changes which turn into qualitative changes. If ever the water's temperature gradually increases, it does not undergo quantitative changes. Quantitative change in water means the increase or decrease in its volume, or the increase or decrease, for example, in a number. As temperature increases, quantitative change is shown by the thermometer. It is the substance, mercury, inside the thermometer and not the water which undergoes a quantitative change. The water undergoes a qualitative change. After turning into steam, the water has not undergone any qualitative change. It has undergone essential change. Its properties have totally changed, and it has become something else. At any rate, it is called passing from quantity to quality. When they reach the point on how sensory superficial knowledge, which is the effect of direct relation between the mind and the objective world, turns into another type of knowledge, for example, logical knowledge, Mao Zedong in his writings, as well as other Marxists, say that it is a matter of passing from quantity to quality. At this juncture, they must be told that if there is really a change from quantity to quality, that is, if this knowledge has indeed essentially changed, then there would be no connection at all between logical knowledge and superficial knowledge, as well as between logical knowledge and the objective world. Why? It is because when the objective world turns into the mental world, like, for example, the pictures taken by a camera, images undergo an essential change. And when there is an essential change, the connection to the objective world shall be basically severed. The relation between logical and superficial knowledge, as well as the relation between logical knowledge and the objective world, is severed. That is, it ends up in absolute idealism. For accordingly, that which I perceived first was water, for example, and then it became steam. It is exactly like saying that I can see water, but in the stage of logical knowledge, it is steam for me and not water. That which is in the objective world is water. In my logical knowledge, water has turned into something else. Once the nature of knowledge changes, it is no longer knowledge. They basically do not know the issues on knowledge. Great philosophers, even in Europe itself, like Kant and Hegel, discerned the issues and enigmas concerning knowledge, and since they discerned them, they looked for the solution, albeit they failed to find the correct one. Yet others were unaware of the main situation. They only know to say that Kant is an idealist. Hegel is an idealist. As far as the issues on knowledge are concerned, there are no idealists at all in the world. When poor Kant said that time and space are not objective, he committed numerous errors on the issue of knowledge. He finally arrived at this solution, and his solution is not correct. There is a difference between a philosopher's commission of a mistake and even a layman's non-commission of the same. That is, a philosopher's commission of a mistake is preferable to a layman's non-commission of the same, let alone a layman's commission of a mistake. Why? It is because the philosopher tries his best to reach a summit. Through a mountainous path full of meanders and not a paved way, while the directions are sometimes unknown for him, he wants to go up alone and reach the peak. The heroic person goes from one curve, from one cliff to another, and is faced with 100 opposite ways he can go. He knows very well which direction to go, but as he reaches the next crossroads, he gets lost. He suddenly stumbles because he thinks that the next cliff is 1,000 meters away. As he wants to resume walking, he becomes undecided and stumbles right away. This person errs and fails to arrive at his destination. On the other hand, the non-heroic person who cannot even think of making a step as he glances at a mountain stands at the foot of a mountain watching silently, and he remains safe. Now, is the one who remains safe superior to the one who made a mistake and fell? The former remains safe because he does not dare to climb. Even just one of the 10 points discovered by the latter is not discovered by the former. The poor fellow discovered 100 uncharted ways. He made a mistake at a certain point, and because of this mistake, he fell and died. The mistake, falling down, and death of the latter are more meritorious than the safety of the former, because the latter took a step. As such, the mistake of figures like that of Kant and Hegel are not without value because they have passed by meanders to some extent, but others have never gone elsewhere, not knowing what and where meanders are. They say that it was a quantity to quality change, and then they think that the problem was solved. Philosophers are entangled with the enigma surrounding the relation between logical knowledge and superficial knowledge, or the relation between intellect and sensory perceptions. What is the kind of relation of such knowledge that can transcend while its nature remains unchanged, yet it expands? It is here that the great philosopher of the Muslim world, Sadr al-Muta'allihin, has presented his theory, which is called transcendent philosophy. Even among Muslims, only a few paid attention to this theory because he discussed it at the sideline of other subjects, how the mind can transcend from the stage of sensory perceptions to a higher stage without losing its nature, and as they call it, changing from quantity to quality. This problem is solved on the basis of the degrees of the self, and conformity with the degrees of the self, which is itself an issue of wide scope. Without taking into account the immateriality of the soul, it is impossible to solve the problems pertaining to knowledge. Now, we must explain some facets of this issue. Russell's view. We have said that logical knowledge in relation to sensory knowledge is exactly like the photographer's work of modifying indefinitely a limited view he has taken picture of. Of course, this is one of the ways in which the mind works. Among the modern philosophers, Russell is aware of this problem, saying that he has no solution to it. He is right. He has failed to find a solution, but at least he had enough maturity to realize that such a problem, such a serious problem, exists. Under the topic, The Problems of Modern Scientific Methods, he initially confuses induction and experiment. He then says, how can I solve this problem in which induction covers a set of particular cases? We inductively infer 10 cases, 20 cases, 1,000 cases, or 10,000 cases. Yet thereafter, we apply the rule we have formed by induction to cases we had not inferred? What is the criterion for this generalization? He has not cited the example I mentioned, but it is a very good example for clarifying the subject. Through this filming device, the device of observation and sensory perceptions, that is, we take footage of different objects. For example, we take pictures of 1,000 objects and adjust them at the same time, but science cannot be established by just 1,000 or 2,000 objects or cases. Science is infinite as far as different objects or cases are concerned. If, according to science, iron expands at a hot temperature, initially one object or case is subjected to induction, then 2 cases, 10 cases, or 1,000 cases are tested, then a general law is immediately formulated, that is, to apply it in general to the cases or objects being observed, by saying that anything of iron in this world, any iron in the past or in the future, is always subject to this general law on iron, that it expands in hot temperature, and this hot temperature is the same, be it in the present, the past, or the future. The views of Abu Ali Sina and Khwaja Nasruddin Tusi. Upon encountering this problem, Abu Ali Sina and Khwaja Nasruddin Tusi solved it in this manner. In every experiment, there is an implicit rule, that is, a sort of intellection and direct inference without any sensory or empirical basis, and that is, there is a primary, axiomatic, and fixed principle inherently grained or ingrained in the human mind. It is inherent not in the case that it exists from birth, but in the sense that as the mind gets stronger through the senses, that principle develops within man. This axiomatic principle, which all people possess and acknowledge, is that the rule on sayings in what may be and what may not be is the same. That is, if we have 2 similar things which are in no way different from each other, their essences are the same. Their secondary properties and conditions are the same. One has no point of difference with the other whatsoever. They are 2 things of the same nature. If one of them has a particular characteristic, it is impossible for the other not to possess a similar characteristic. Otherwise, it is a case of likely without preponderant, which is impossible. For example, after removing the conditions, we reach the conclusion that the expansion of iron in hot temperature has something to do with its nature, because iron, metal in particular, has such a characteristic. And this expansion does not depend on the conditions this iron potentially has. In this way, it is impossible for one thing to have a certain characteristic, while the other one does not have the same. If it is so, it then signifies likely without preponderant, and likely without preponderant is the primary, axiomatic, and rational principle, something which cannot be. In experiments, we obtain logical knowledge from superficial knowledge because, in superficial knowledge, we change so many conditions. For example, when we conduct an experiment about medicine for tuberculosis or the expansion of iron in hot temperature, we reach the point that apart from these 2 factors, hot temperature and iron, or medicine and a tuberculosis patient, no other factor has any role to play. When this medicine, and not any other thing, proves effective on a tuberculosis patient, and not on any other patient, it is then impossible that this medicine will not have the same effect on any other tuberculosis patient. Felician Chalai's view. Felician Chalai was one of those who were aware of the problem, but unable to solve it. Chalai expresses it in this manner. The human mind dictates that nature undergoes a uniform process. This is a principle which you also accept. The Marxists accept it too. For example, try to say to a Marxist, the Soviet Union was in such and such condition, and its system changed from capitalism to socialism, and there is another country in the world whose conditions are exactly the same as the Soviet Union, that is, its economic, geographical, demographic and cultural conditions are exactly like that of the Soviet Union, and there is not even an iota of difference between them. Now, in your opinion, will this country become socialist? He will say that the said country will definitely become socialist. It is impossible for nature not to undergo a uniform process in a totally identical situation, and if it is not so, scientific law has basically no meaning at all. Scientific law means that nature undergoes a uniform process. The same is true in social law. Shalahi says that if we experiment in 10 cases, 20 cases, or 1,000 cases, we observe that in those cases, such and such phenomenon is in such and such form. Then, based on the principle that nature undergoes a uniform process, we make a generalization out of the results. Finally, we reach this law, which is a general one. From where is the general law obtained? Shalahi is also aware of the fact that if we say this law is also an empirical law, then how is this law applied generally? Is it applied generally by self-help? He says that such a thing is impossible. Thus, the enigma of science is not yet solved. It is not so. In fact, this enigma of science has been solved. For all logical empirical knowledge, as everybody acknowledges, there is a form of purely intellective, deductive knowledge in which empirical knowledge is anchored. Therefore, the intellect takes precedence over experience. That is, had it not been for the intellective, deductive knowledge, which is based upon primary axioms, it would not have been possible for logical empirical knowledge to exist. It is here that the main question on knowledge reaches a very crucial point, which only a few philosophers have paid attention to, and that is the solution to this problem. How can sensory superficial knowledge turn into logical knowledge? One says that it is passing from quantity to quality, which denotes the worthless absolute idealism. Another says that it is based upon this law that nature undergoes a uniform process. He then asks himself, what is the basis of this law's general application? Is it self-help? This is impossible. With this, the enigma remains unsolved. Another question must be posed to Shalahi. You yourself say that this law cannot be applied generally by relying on itself. Why can it not be applied? You say that it is impossible. Shalahi, what is wrong with impossible? Is to be impossible an empirical law? Have we experimented and discovered that it is impossible? Is impossible capable of being experimented on at all? Impossible means that it does not exist, and it is not possible to exist, and it will never come into existence. What can be experimented is only that which exists. You are stuck on this enigma based upon a purely rational law, and that is, it is impossible. You cannot say that it is not impossible. So, from where have you obtained this impossible? Such are the errors of these learned men. They have gone too much to the summit, reaching many things. For this reason, we respect their views. For example, Shalahi has at least reached such a point, but upon reaching it, he stumbled down. His view is so valuable compared to those who have not paid attention to these issues and problems at all. Some just say that the mind gives general application to laws and principles, and so the problem is solved. A photographer comes and takes pictures or a picture of 10 persons, and then in the dark room, he develops the picture of all people, and all are consistent with reality. Is such a thing possible? Even then, a stupendous, fantastic, and subtle function of the mind is that it can develop, expand, and nurture knowledge. What is more stupendous and fantastic is that the mind can expand knowledge not only in its length, width, dimension. In fact, it has the power to develop knowledge in another dimension, and that is what we call profound or inferential knowledge. Knowledge about God can be justified within this context, and I will explain this subject to you in the next session, God willingly. And with that being said, may God's salutations be upon Muhammad and his pure progeny. End of chapter 5.